One does not build a stupendous war machine in a fit of passion, nor an Auschwitz factory during a passing spasm of brutality.
What if I told you that in its quest to become the dominant superpower, the United States willingly brought more than 1,600 former Nazi scientists into the country?
What these men did was done with the utmost deliberation.
The once powerful Nazi war machinery is slowly crumbling to dust.
Imagine a post-World War II world, where the lines between enemy and ally blur, and the pursuit of power leads to morally questionable choices. That's exactly what unfolded in one of the most controversial operations in U.S. history, Operation Paperclip. It's a story of secret deals, ethical compromise, and the race for global dominance in science and technology.
You who have not seen it do not know what hell looks like from the top. That's what Germany looks like.
As the Third Reich collapsed, the Allies were not only hunting down Nazi war criminals, they were also scrambling to capture Germany's most brilliant minds. Why? Because these scientists had pioneered advancements in everything from rocket technology to chemical weapons, knowledge that could be used to tip the balance of power in a post-war world. The United States and Soviet Union were locked in a shadowy competition, each trying to gain control of these intellectual resources. These men, some of whom had committed horrific crimes, were given new lives, new jobs, and even new identities. Welcome to the dark, ethically fraught world of Operation Paperclip.
Don't say that he's hypocritical. Say rather that he's apolitical. Once the rockets are up, who cares where they come down? That's not my department, says Wernher von Braun.
Almost exactly 16 months after the A-bomb is dropped on Hiroshima, the U.S. Army is about to make its first major test of a ballistic rocket.
Initially known as Operation Overcast, was named for the paperclips that were attached to the files of scientists that the U.S. deemed most valuable. One of the most famous figures to emerge from this operation was Wernher von Braun, the mastermind behind the Nazi V-2 rockets that had terrorized Allied cities.
An altitude of 117 miles will be achieved, a world's record. This rocket is not American, however. It is German.
These deadly rockets were designed in part by prisoners forced to work in inhuman conditions at the Mittelwerk factory. Von Braun wasn't just a passive bystander in this atrocity. He personally selected slave laborers from the Buchenwald concentration camp. Yet despite his Nazi past, Von Braun became a central figure in the U.S. space program, eventually helping to develop the Saturn V rocket that took Americans to the moon.
To help show you what is being done to solve these problems, we have called upon one of the foremost exponents of space travel, Dr. Wernher von Braun, who is at present the chief of the Guided Missile Division of the Army's Rocket Center at Redstone Arsenal.
But von Braun was only the tip of the iceberg. Let's talk about some of the other key players in Operation Paperclip and the morally dubious roles they played. Working with von Braun was Arthur Rudolph, who served as a production manager at the Mittelwerk facility. Under his oversight, workers endured brutal conditions, starvation, and inhumane treatment, leading to the death of thousands.
Some people believe that the reports of what happened there are exaggerated. No words could exaggerate.
Yet despite this dark past, Rudolph's expertise in rocketry made him an asset to the United States during the Cold War. Brought to America under Operation Paperclip, he became a key figure in NASA's space program, playing a significant role in developing the Saturn V rocket that enabled the Apollo moon landing. For years, he was celebrated as a hero of American science, even receiving prestigious accolades for his work.
Now I'd like to show you a department of our school, which is a logical outgrowth of what you've been seeing.
However, when his involvement in Nazi war crimes resurfaced in the 1980s, Rudolph was forced to give up his U.S. citizenship and return to Germany largely escaping formal justice. But let's not forget another pivotal player.
For this story, you ought to talk to Dr. Hubertus Strughold.
Strughold had been involved in experiments at the Dachau concentration camp, where prisoners were subjected to cruel and lethal experiments on how the human body responds to extreme conditions. Despite the evidence of his wartime atrocities, Strughold's name was eventually cleared, once again, in the interest of national security. In the United States, Strughold became a key figure in NASA's medical program, developing life support systems and astronaut training protocols.
Dr. Strughold, what are the prospects for space travel?
We'll not only make routine flights under space conditions in the vicinity of the Earth, but also that he will travel to or around the moon.
Now let's shift to some Nazi doctors, some of whom were even tried at Nuremberg. Dr. Kurt Blom, for example, had been the Deputy Surgeon General of Nazi Germany, overseeing biological warfare research that included testing on prisoners.
Professor Kurt Blomer, the Deputy Health Minister and Plenipotentiary for Cancer Research, favored testing the extract in mice, but Rascher insisted on using human test subjects. Himmler took Rascher aside, and a human cancer testing station was established at Dachau concentration camp.
When captured, Blom was charged with war crimes at the Nuremberg trials, but shockingly he was acquitted, thanks in large part to U.S. intervention.
Taking their places in the famous Nuremberg courtroom, judges of the Allied military tribunal begin the trial of minor war criminals.
Otto Ambrose.
And then there was Otto Ambrose, a chemist who had helped develop nerve agents like sarin and tabun for the Nazis. Ambrose had overseen chemical plants that used slave labor from Auschwitz, where countless workers perished.
In conquered Poland, Ambrose was shown a town where one of Himmler's largest concentration camps had just been built. The town was Oswiecim, known to the Germans as Auschwitz. Ambrose found the site otherwise suitable and was particularly interested in the possibility of using the concentration camp inmates to erect the plant, all of which was reported to the other defendants. They agreed.
He was convicted at Nuremberg, but instead of serving his full sentence, he was quietly brought to the United States to work on chemical weapons development. Ambrose was so essential to U.S. military interests that he was even granted a pardon, allowing him to continue his work with impunity. These men helped shape America's post-war scientific and military achievements, but their past were anything but clean.
Ambrose was part of the chemical weapons scientists that were of great interest to the United States.
So why did the U.S. welcome them with open arms? The answer lies in the geopolitical reality of the time. The Cold War had begun, and with the Soviet Union snapping up German scientists in its own operation, the U.S. couldn't afford to fall behind. National security was the justification. And for many, the ends seemed to justify the means. But this operation wasn't just a military endeavor. It was also a covert CIA initiative. The Central Intelligence Agency, newly formed in 1947, was instrumental in facilitating the transfer of these Nazi scientists into the U.S., often erasing or downplaying their Nazi affiliations in the process. Let's explore some of the key figures in the CIA who played significant roles in Operation Paperclip. One of the most notable was Alan Dulles, the first civilian director of Central Intelligence. Dulles was a master of espionage and covert operations, and during his tenure, he prioritized harnessing scientific talent, no matter the moral cost.
Mr. Dulles, I know you've heard this many times, but there are people who say that we, with regard to the CIA, are waging a secret war with an invisible government.
We are obviously engaged in many facets of what is generally called the Cold War.
Dulles had been deeply involved in intelligence gathering during World War II as a senior officer in the Office of Strategic Services, OSS, the CIA's precursor. After the war, he became an architect of Operation Paperclip, pushing hard for the recruitment of German scientists. Dulles believed that if the U.S. didn't act quickly, the Soviets would recruit these same scientists, which could have catastrophic consequences in the Cold War.
The KGB is one of the most sinister organizations that ever was organized.
Are they any good? Are the Russians good at this?
Oh, yes. Oh, my. You take some of their operations, they're classic.
Then there's John J. McCloy, another key figure in the operation. McCloy had served as Assistant Secretary of War during World War II and was later appointed to the U.S. High Commissioner for Germany, effectively overseeing the occupation of Germany after the war.
John McCloy's had a long life, 90 years, and most of it marked by unparalleled service to his country and humanity.
McCloy was instrumental in negotiating the terms that allowed many of these scientists, including war criminals, to escape prosecution and work for the U.S. government. And let's not forget about James Jesus Angleton, the infamous head of counterintelligence at the CIA. Angleton, known for his paranoia and obsession with Soviet espionage, viewed the recruitment of Nazi scientists as a necessary evil.
There are those, of course, who would say that the CIA's wings were simply clipped, that they had been going too far, too fast, too freely.
Oh, there are those who will say anything.
Angleton helped run counterintelligence programs that monitored the activities of former Nazi scientists once they were bought into the United States, ensuring that they were loyal to their new homeland.
There is always a question whether a democratic country is capable of having an intelligence service of any great merit.
One figure who bridges the gap between science, intelligence, and Nazi war crimes is Reinhard Gehlen. Gehlen was a Nazi intelligence officer who had run the Wehrmacht's intelligence service on the Eastern Front. After the war, Gehlen offered his vast intelligence network to the Americans, promising valuable insight into Soviet military operations.
Thereafter, until his break with Hitler in April 1945, Gehlen reported regularly on all matters to do with Russia's war effort, gathering his information from agents inside the Soviet Union, some inside the Kremlin itself.
Alan Dulles and the CIA embraced him, establishing the Gehlen Organization, a secret West German intelligence service that operated under U.S. guidance. The Gehlen Organization became a key asset in the early Cold War, though it was staffed by many former Nazis. Operation Paperclip wasn't just about advancing science and technology. It was about creating a powerful network of individuals who could outthink, outmaneuver, and outbuild the Soviets. The ethical lines were blurred and in many cases, completely crossed. These scientists, with their dark pasts, weren't simply forgotten. They were actively protected and promoted by the U.S. government. One of the most damning cases of moral compromise involves the infamous MKUltra program, which was initiated by the CIA in the 50s. Nazi scientists brought over under Operation Paperclip played a key role in the early stages of this mind control program, which involved unethical experiments on unwanted subjects, including the use of hallucinogenic drugs and psychological torture. Sidney Gottlieb, the CIA officer who ran MKUltra, reportedly worked with some of these former Nazi scientists to develop methods of controlling the human mind, methods that were disturbingly similar to techniques used in Nazi concentration camps. By the mid-20th century, many of the scientists recruited under Operation Paperclip had become household names. Wernher von Braun was featured on Walt Disney's TV specials talking about space exploration and the future of mankind's journey to the stars.
Now here's a model, my design for a four-stage orbital rocket ship. Compared to the unmanned instrument rocket, it is quite large.
Von Braun had gone from a man developing weapons of mass destruction for the Nazis to an American icon, symbolizing the triumph of science and innovation. But what the public didn't see were the compromises that had been made to get there. And these compromises didn't go unnoticed by everyone. Prominent figures like Albert Einstein and Eleanor Roosevelt were vocal critics of Operation Paperclip. Einstein, who had fled Nazi Germany before the war, wrote a letter to President Truman condemning the decision to allow these men into the country.
We are concerned here with an act of humanity
He believed that the United States was sacrificing its moral integrity for the sake of power, and he was right to question whether these scientists' contributions could ever justify the atrocities they had committed. But for the U.S. government, it wasn't about morality, it was about survival. The Cold War was a battle for global supremacy, and the Soviet Union was seen as an existential threat. The Americans couldn't afford to let the Soviets get their hands on these scientific minds. National security became the ultimate justification, even if it meant sweeping the horrors of the past under the rug. Operation Paperclip represents one of the most complex moral dilemmas in American history. The questions posed by Operation Paperclip are not just relics of the past, they remain deeply relevant today. In a world still grappling with the ethics of technological progress and global power dynamics, we're often reminded that the pursuit of dominance, whether through scientific innovation, military strength, or intelligence gathering, can come at an immense moral cost. Take, for example, the development of nuclear weapons.
Now I am become death.
The Manhattan Project, led by figures like J. Robert Oppenheimer and Enrico Fermi, was instrumental in creating the atomic bomb, a device that forever changed the nature of warfare. But the lessons learned through Operation Paperclip echo through these projects as well.
Repeating once again our top story, Soviet President Mikhail Gorbachev has been removed from power, and there are tanks now in the streets of Moscow. Vice President Gennady Yanayev says he has taken over as acting president.
Even after the Cold War ended, the legacy of Operation Paperclip continued to influence U.S. policy. How far are we willing to push the boundaries of science if it means we gain the upper hand, even if it leaves a trail of destruction in its wake? And what about modern warfare, where technologies such as drones, artificial intelligence, and cyber weapons have emerged as the new frontiers of battle? These innovations, much like the rocket technology developed by von Braun, are impressive on a technical level, but come with their own ethical dilemmas. How do we ensure that technological progress does not come at the expense of humanity? Are we destined to repeat the same mistakes, making compromises in the name of progress? Or can we find a way to advance technology without losing sight of our moral obligations? What do you think? Was Operation Paperclip a necessary evil? Or does it reveal something more troubling about the choices we make in the pursuit of power? If this exploration of Operation Paperclip has made you think twice about the price of scientific advancement, make sure to like this video, subscribe, and click the notification bell so you don't miss out on future explorations of history's most controversial moments.